Blackstone Audio presents Isolation, a Faye Longchamp mystery by Mariana Evans. This book is read by Cassandra Campbell. For Little Oliver. Excerpt from the oral history of Callie Stanton, recorded in 1935 and preserved as part of the WPA slave narratives.
Secrets hold power. My mama told me so more than 90 years back. The power of secrets holds true for everybody, I expect. But it holds a lot more true for people who ain't got power of their own. Think about a young girl born a slave. Try to imagine that she has any power over her missus at all. You can't, can you? Now think about a young girl, almost a woman, who has been tending her missus since she was big enough to carry a chamber pot. Maybe before that. Maybe she's been tending her missus since she was old enough to carry a bottle of bourbon. Maybe she's spent her short life listening to the things her missus says when she's been into the bourbon since noontime. A young girl like that knows how much her missus pines for her home up north. She knows how much her missus wishes the massa remembered where her bedchamber was. She knows the thing that even the missus can't know, because she can't think it when she's sober. Only after several goodly portions of bourbon can her missus listen to herself say, "He married me for my money. Now it's his. And all I've got for company is you, Callie." So yeah, you could say that I stepped out of my cradle knowing how to keep a secret, and I stepped into womanhood knowing how to use it to my advantage. Maybe you're thinking that I'm heartless with my secrets, using them for my gain and for the ruin of others. No, that ain't so. Sometimes there is only one gift a body can give another person. Sometimes that gift is silence.
Chapter 1. Fish know which docks are owned by people who are generous with their table scraps. In the evenings, they gather around wooden posts that vibrate with the footsteps of a human carrying food. They wait, knowing that potato peels and pork chop bones will soon rain from the sky. They race to skim the surface for floating breadcrumbs. They dive, nibbling at each half-eaten hot dog as it sinks. When a restaurant, even a shabby dive where hungry people clean their plates, throws its detritus off one particular dock every night, fish for miles around know all about it. On this night, the fish wait below a dock that has always offered a nightly feast. Tonight, they feel the vibrations of familiar feet. The food falls into the water as always, and the sound of a stainless steel spoon scraping the bottom of a stainless steel pot passes from the air above to the water below. Everything is as it has been, until a sharp noise jabs into the water hard enough for the fish to hear it. The spoon falls. The spoon is large, designed for a commercial kitchen, so it hits the water with a smack that can be heard both above and below the surface. A scream falls into the fish's underworld along with the spoon. A big pot, with food scraps still clinging to its inner surface, hits the water an instant later. Only creatures with the agility of the waiting fish could scatter quickly enough to avoid being hit. After another heartbeat, something else falls among them, something bigger and softer. Soon there are two somethings, both with arms and legs and feet and hands, one that gurgles and another that leaves when the gurgling stops. The thing that stays behind is a human body. As it settles in the water, tiny minnows nestle in the long hair that floats around it like seaweed.
Catfish explore its 10 long fingers with their tentacled mouths. None of them associate its 2 bare feet with the sprightly vibrations that had always signaled a rain of food. Before long, predators appear, drawn by the smell of blood. Chapter 2. Joe Wolf Mantooth was worried about his wife. Faye was neglecting their business. She was neglecting her health. He wanted to say she was neglecting her children, but it would kill her to think he believed such a thing. So he spent a lot of time telling that part of himself to be quiet. He also wanted to say she was neglecting him, but it would kill him to believe it. So he spent the rest of his time telling that other part of himself to be quiet, or to shrivel up and die. Because if he ever lost Faye, that's what Joe intended to do, shrivel up and die. The children seemed oblivious to the changes in their mother. Michael, at 2, saw nothing strange about her leaving the house every morning with her archaeological tools. She had always done that. Amand was away from home, doing an immersion course in Spanish at a camp situated so high in the Appalachians that she'd asked for heavy sweaters long before Halloween. Faye had been too distracted to put them in the mail. Joe had shopped for them, boxed them up, and sent them off. Faye seemed to have forgotten that her daughter had ever said, "I'm cold." Amand was perceptive for 17. If she hadn't noticed that Joe had been doing all the talking for the last month, she would notice soon. Lately, when faced with a call from her daughter, Faye murmured a few distracted words before pretending that Michael needed a diaper change. If Faye didn't come up with another excuse to get off the phone, Amand might soon call 911 and ask the paramedics to go check out her brother's chronic diarrhea. Though Joe did speak to Amand when she called, surely she had noticed by now that he said exactly nothing. What was he going to say? The closest thing to the truth was, "Your mother's heart fell into a deep hole when she miscarried your baby sister."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.